Well, good morning, everyone. We want to welcome you to the service this morning. Would you stand with me, please? We'll draw your attention to the screen as we open up with our song this morning, I Surrender All. Psalm 99, 1 through 9 together. The Lord reigns, let the peoples tremble. He dwells between the cherubim, let the earth be moved. The Lord is great in Zion, and he is high above all the peoples. Let them praise your great and awesome name. He is holy. The king's strength also loves justice. You have established equity. You have executed justice and righteousness in Jacob. Exalt the Lord our God and worship at his footstool. He is holy. Moses and Aaron were among his priests, and Samuel was among those who called upon his name. They called upon the Lord, and he answered them. He spoke to them in the cloudy pillar. They kept his testimonies and the ordinance he gave them. You answered them, O Lord our God. You were to them God who forgives, though you took vengeance on their deeds. Exalt the Lord our God and worship at his holy hill, for the Lord our God is holy. Amen. The Lord our God is holy. Let's take a moment and greet one another in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and then we dismiss the junior church. Amen.
Not that young. Good morning, South Swansea. How's everybody doing this morning?
Good morning.
Beautiful day we have today. Just some quick announcements. If you look at your bulletin, and I'll mention a couple that are not there as well. 9:45, following our service, we have our FBT class with the guys up here with Judy downstairs. So feel free to come out and kind of dig a little bit deeper into God's Word. We have lessons every week, and we pose questions, and we sometimes even kind of go back and forth and pick each other's brains. So come out, 9:45, the men up here as well as the ladies downstairs. Also, I just want to, this Wednesday, we usually have our Bible study and prayer time on Wednesdays at 7 here in the sanctuary. But this week, Pastor's going to have it at the parsonage, and we're going to meet at 6 o'clock. So when we're going to have, prior to our study at 7, we're going to have ice cream. So you're going to have ice cream at 6, from 6 to 7, and Pastor asks if you could bring your favorite Bible verse. If you come on Wednesday nights, or even if you never come out on Wednesday nights, come out. We're going to have some nice ice cream. Hopefully the weather cooperates. It's at 6 o'clock, and again, like I mentioned, bring your favorite Bible verse, and how has it impacted your life personally. So that'll be this Wednesday night at 6 o'clock. We'll be in the back of the parsonage. If you can't make it for 6, they'll still have the Bible study and prayer time at 7, so if you're a little late, it's okay. We'll be back there from that same amount of time, from 6 to 8 o'clock. Normally, usually pastor usually closes around 10 out, 5 out for prayer time. So come out Wednesday night. Also, just a reminder, we're already getting closer to fall. I know it sounds depressing. Pretty soon the white stuff will be falling. not that I want to ruin it. I know some people like winter, so. But anyways, yes, exactly. The kids love that stuff. So, but keep an eye out for the dates for Blast, for Junior Church, Sunshine Bunch, all those groups, and just pay attention to your bulletin each and every week, and we'll probably most likely announce it as well. Also, another announcement is opportunities to serve in our church. You know, I'll mention this kind of like what we talk about in FBT. A couple of weeks ago, I did a lesson in FBT about serving, you know, that God uses all of us, you know, no matter what. Sometimes we may look in the mirror and say, well, what do I have to offer God in a church? Whether it's greeting at a door. The one thing I learned when I first started ushering in a church years ago is remember people's names. You'd be amazed how far that goes. When someone comes to church once a month and you still remember their name, it impacts them. So God can use you in any way, whether you want to be a greeter, whether you want to help out in some type of ministry. Don't feel that you're not so-called good enough, or you don't have the talents or the gifts. So please feel free. If there's a God's tugging on your heart to serve, feel free to talk to Pastor, and he'll put you somewhere. Because I know We're always looking for people to serve in our church and in the church in general. Also, just a reminder for the men, Grace and Granite is this coming Saturday, and that'll be at 8 o'clock downstairs in the fellowship hall. So guys, come out. I'd pick on Joe today, but I don't see him. He usually brings the malasadas, so we have malasadas, coffee, donuts. So feel free to come out and be a great time of fellowship and a great lesson from Pastor. And just one final note, answered prayer, praise for Estelle's son-in-law, Peter LaCroix. I know we've mentioned him from the pulpit here. Pastor's mentioned him. We also pray for him on Wednesday nights. He's going home this Tuesday. So praise God for that. And the good thing about it, like Estelle was telling me in the back when I walked in, that his daughter's going to college on Thursday. So he actually gets to send his daughter off to college while he's home. So I know she said he's limited. He only can lift, I think, no more than 20 to 40 pounds, I believe. So Estelle wants to thank everyone in the church for praying for him. And just praise God that he's heading back home this coming Tuesday. So with that, we'll close in prayer, and I'll pray for the offering. I believe we have one more song. Dear Lord, we just thank you this morning. We praise you, Lord, for Brother Peter LaCroix, for Stella's son-in-law. We just thank you, and we praise you, Lord, for the healing you've given him and the opportunity to send his daughter away to college this coming week. So we just praise you for that, and we thank you for that, Lord. We pray for our offering this morning. That you just bless it, bless our hearts to give this morning, wherever. This morning that you've tugged at our hearts, Lord, to give through missionaries, through our church, our community, our tithes, our offerings, Lord. I just ask you just to bless it, bless our pastor this morning with the message that we brought forth, that it just permeate our hearts, Lord, to challenge us to serve and serve you wholeheartedly, Lord. And we thank you and praise you in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Christ will hold me fast. justice has been satisfied, he will hold me fast. Raised with him to endless life, he will hold me fast. Till that faith is cast to sight,
sometimes how you get through the day, just knowing that our God will hold us fast. Amen?
Amen.
I love that song. So many of those songs that I love, the words, the lyric of that, how that speaks truth into our hearts. Well, it's good to see you this morning, and we pray the Lord's blessing be upon you. Lenny was making the announcements, and I was reminded, thinking up, you know, he talked about summer. You know, we have 4 more weeks of summer. Isn't that something? I mean, it seems like it just started. It seemed like, you know, all of a sudden the first day we were here talking about the first day of summer in June. And now we have 4 more weeks. And, of course, I think the official, unofficial last of summer is usually around Labor Day, right? I think that's when people take that last big blast of summer weekend, they call it. So that'll be here before you know it. So I'll tell you what, let's just pray. Every day is a brand new day with God, whether it's sunshine, raining, snow, dare I say that word, or any other type of weather, we praise the Lord that we can meet with him on a daily basis. Couple prayer requests, few prayer requests we share with you this morning, and then we are going to go into our message. Before the prayer request, just again mention to you, we would love to host you, have you on this coming Wednesday, meeting at 6 o'clock in the yard up behind the parsonage for our little ice cream fellowship. You say, well, I don't normally come on Wednesday night. Well, you can come this Wednesday night. We'll have some fellowship together before we go into our study. Bring your favorite Bible verse. Bring your favorite passage. We'll talk about those things together as we gather ourselves around, and we look forward to those things. And if you are looking at, as again, as Lenny mentioned this morning, a place of service in this ministry. If you're a member and you say, you know, I'm really not actively engaged, I'm not actively connected, serving the Lord in some capacity throughout the ministries of the church, we have several opportunities in mind, so see us, and we would love to mention some of those to you and try to line up with what your gifting or ability would be, or maybe even stretch you a little bit beyond your gift or ability that you might enjoy serving the Lord in that way in this place. And we would appreciate that. So some of these prayer requests we have for you. Continue to be in prayer for those who are homebound. Gertrude Aguiar, Armand and Sue Ramos, for their health and watch care. Also our sister Pat Aguiar for her continued healing. Helen Bouchard for her health. Bob Gillett, his rehab, he is in Clifton now, sustaining that. Remember, he sustained a stroke, and now his mind is clear, the speech is there, but there's some other health issues with him going on, and so let's pray for his rehab. Tony Geary, one of our ladies, she just had surgery recently. She's home healing and rehabbing. And then pray for our folks that had the knee replacement surgery. That's Brother Al Kozatek and Sheila Oliveira as they're rehabbing from this surgery. And I see Janet out there. So Janet, give us a word. How's that man of yours doing?
He's
Excellent, excellent. Excellent, praise the Lord. And so we look to see him soon, and just continue to be in prayer as he rehabs that. Also, be in prayer for our missionaries that we support, not only in this country, but various places around the globe. Mission board is up there. You can take some letters and read about them. And while I'm thinking about missionaries, there's a couple other things that come to mind. Of late, I don't know if you've been noticing, I get so much news and information on the Christian wire along these things. The churches, persecuted believers, whether it's in China, India, Pakistan, Nigeria, things that are going on around the world. I read an article in India, I believe it's up in the northeast part of India, where they said so far there have been over 300 Christian churches destroyed. And some terrible, terrible things going on around the world in that. And so we want to pray for our brothers and sisters there. And while we're thinking about those, one of our missionary families we support are the Brunks there in Maui. And of course, you remember, you've been seeing it on the news, the families that have been affected by the Western Maui wildfires. And I checked this morning, and right now they're up to 114 fatalities, with over 1,000 people missing, somewhere around 1,000, 1,300 people missing. So we have been getting emails from the Bronx as to what they're trying to do to help, and we're going to see what involvement we might be able to have to kind of chip in with them, and try to help out in that area. I can't even imagine people as they saw these fires. Could you imagine if you saw fires coming through the woods or around your neighborhood? And there's no stopping these things, and all you can do is run. All you can do is seek to get away. Some of these families didn't even have time to get in an automobile and try to drive. They just ran. And, of course, being on the island, where are they going to run? They run toward the ocean. And even in the ocean, there were fatalities there in the ocean as a result of having to run from these fires, this inferno. And so we want to certainly be in prayer for these folks. So let's lift our requests. Also, again, continue to remember Peter LaCroix, as Lenny mentioned to us this morning in the announcement, who's going home on Tuesday. He still has a way to go before he's back 100%. So remember him in your prayers as well. So let's take these things to the Lord. Father, thank you for Jesus. We thank you for this opportunity that we have to come before you in prayer. We believe in prayer. We believe as a church, we not only pray individually, but there's a call for us to pray as a church corporately. And we come together lifting up brothers and sisters in the faith, and family and friends alike. And Father, I ask and pray you be with these who are homebound. Lord, they would love to be here. They're not able. And so we are grateful for those who can access the service that's recorded for them and shown available in their home. I pray for their health. I pray that you watch over them and meet every need. And help us, Lord, where we can help them. We pray for Pat as she's been through some health issues. Lord, that you continue to watch over her. For Helen, the same. That you would strengthen these ladies. Bring Helen out to us again soon as she's been away. For Bob in rehab in Clifton, Father, Marie's husband, Lord, that you would just be with him and help him with the therapy that he receives, that he might receive strength every day. Tony, touch her body and strengthen her. We're grateful for this good word from Janet today about Al. We pray you continue to be with him in that healing process and strengthen him that we might see him again soon. Sheila, the same. God, that you just work. She had a process, and Lord, we pray for her rehab and for her healing. We might see them again soon. I ask and pray for our church missionaries. Father, we are so grateful for the privilege, and it truly is a privilege for us, to be able to lift them in prayer, but not only that, to be able to support them with our finances. God, I pray you bless us as a church, that you continue to help us to be missionary-minded, seeking to get the word of the gospel of Jesus out around the world. And Father, as I think of them, I think of one of our missionaries in Maui who are ministering to those who've been affected in the Lahani wildfires there, and for the number of fatalities and those still unaccounted for. God, that you would help
Thank you for the ministries that have moved in there, Operation Blessing, Good Samaritan, the Samaritan's Purse Ministry, and others. And we pray for the Brunk family as their church startup seeks to help families and minister to their needs. We pray about the persecuted believers, Lord. We often think persecuted believers. Our mind goes to places like China, underground churches, and so forth. But we see more persecution picking up in various other countries, whether it be India or Israel or Pakistan or Nigeria or a whole host of countries. Father, I pray, would you watch over the believers there? Would you strengthen them? Would you encourage their hearts? Would you help us to be faithful in praying for them, to do whatever we can on our end of things by prayer and sometimes sending love gifts to strengthen the brothers and sisters in Christ? I ask and pray that you be with the message this morning as we look once again at Jesus' sermon in Matthew chapter 7, that you might work it into our hearts and through our lives on a daily basis. I think it's a message we all need. We ask your blessing be upon us in Jesus' name. Amen. Matthew chapter 7 in your Bible. As you're turning to Matthew chapter 7, we had our vacation Bible school. You see some of the decor is still up, and it's coming down in increments, some of the decoration. But I tell you what, I really like this front. I like the castle look. I love the colors. It needs to come down eventually, but when it does, everything looks so bare, you know. But they did a nice job with that. We had a wonderful vacation Bible school. And I've had a few people ask me, were there any information on the penny march yet? And, well, yes, that we finally were able to get it all done. In fact, I have to admit, going in to the bank to get the pennies counted, you used to be able to drop these things off and come back in a couple of days and no more. Now they have these penny machines. You have to stand there and slowly pour it in and count. Well, I think I broke the machine like four times. And the woman said, can I help you? I said, yeah, it keeps gagging. It keeps asking for somebody else. You know, it needs to be repaired. And she looked and she said, oh my goodness, it's too many pennies at one time. She said, you can only put them in a trickle. I said, I put them in a trickle, I'll be here all day long, you know. But as it was, I was there with the penny machine for almost 2.5 hours, just trickling this stuff in. Because anytime I tried to do a little extra, the machine went, oh, and I'm, oh, what do I do now? You know, I'm not going to get in the floor and count them out by hand. And so anyway, all that being said, our VBS penny march, we wasn't the lowest, wasn't the highest, it fell somewhere in the middle of the road, but still, we praise the Lord for every penny that comes in, right? Yeah. Well, two of you agree. We praise the Lord for every penny that comes in, right? Amen. And so for every soul, every person that was ministered to. Anyway, our penny march this year came to $956.12. So still, that's quite a bit in pennies, right? Especially when you come in with two buckets and they say, how many more do you got? I say, I got six more buckets in my car. What? Oh, okay. You know, when they say, hey, how can I help you? I think they're sorry that they said that after you tell them how many more pennies you got. But anyway, that's what it was. And so we praise the Lord for that. And we didn't break the scale. Even on that Friday, a good bunch of that came in on Friday because kids really got into that and building those buckets up. Our buckets are tired. They won't be used next year because the handles are about ready to let go. But it was a lot of fun. And thank you for praying for VBS. And now we're already making preparations for VBS 2024. And so if you just keep that somewhere locked in your mind, and maybe we've had a couple of people take a few days vacation to help us with VBS this year. Maybe you might want to join us next year. We'd look forward to that. Matthew chapter 7. Matthew chapter 7. We're going to read from verses 13 and 14. We shared with you last time out of Matthew in verse 13, enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate, and narrow is, and broad is the way that leads to destruction, and there are many who go in by it. Because narrow is the gate, and difficult is the way which leads to life, eternal life, and there are few who find it. So we already walked through together and unpacked a lot of verses 13 and 14 of Matthew chapter 7. However, As Jesus shared in this Sermon on the Mount, he spoke of these two ways, the way to destruction, verse 13, the way to life, verse 14. In describing these two ways, he points out some contrast. And this is what he says, that the way to destruction is broad. It's wide. And many choose to follow it. The way to life, eternal life, the way to life is difficult, and there are few who find it. And so based on what Jesus said right there, we want to spend just a little bit more time in verses 13 and 14 and talk to you a little bit today about the difficult way to life. Now, I don't know if you recall when you received Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. I remember my own experience. I remember the day. I remember the place, the address. I remember the time. It was a huge experience to me. And that doesn't mean that we have to remember all those things. I just happened to. But I remember that when I went into this particular building, there was a snowstorm outside. January the 5th, 1976. And I remember after I spoke with a pastor in the building who asked me a question when I went in, because he covenanted with God a long time ago that if ever God allowed him into ministry, that if anybody ever came into a building where he was the pastor, before they got out of the building, he was going to ask them this one question. And the question was, if you died today, do you know where you'd spend eternity? And he said, with the help of God, he said, most of the people that come in here for anything, whether it's a telephone repair man, or it's the electric company man, or it's somebody for an appointment, anybody that comes in, he said, I can honestly say, some of them got away, he said, without the question. But the majority of them, he told me, he said, I asked that of them. And so on that morning when I went there, he asked it of me. And it was the third time that I was approached about my relationship to Almighty God. The first two times I shoved away. I wasn't interested. N.I. Not interested. Didn't want it. Didn't want to hear about it. But for some reason, and now I know, I believe it was the Holy Spirit of God who pricked my heart to listen to that man when he said that question and asked me with a follow-up, can I take the Bible and show you how you can know Jesus as your personal Savior? And so I walked into that building. It was in the midst of a snowstorm. It was cold. It was blowing. It was deep. I came to know Jesus Christ as my personal Savior, and when I came out of that building, I was still in the midst of a snowstorm. It was still cold, it was still blowing, it was still deep. And I say that to you because I've heard people say, well, when I trusted Jesus, the sky looked bluer and the grass was greener and the cold wind became warmer and the waters calmed and all these. That didn't happen for me. I wish it had happened to me. That would have been a great experience to enjoy that. But it didn't happen to me. What I'm saying to you is we want to spend a few moments with you and look at this in verse 14 when Jesus said, if we enter the narrow gate, he said, we come to this narrow gate. It's the gate because the narrow gate, he said in verse 14, it difficult is the way, he says, which leads to eternal life. And sometimes people say, oh, when I came to know the Lord, everything was peace be still. I don't know. Did you find that to be true? Not necessarily with my experience. You know, sometimes it gets, yeah, that can happen, right? The difference, though, I find that the difference when I still go through the situations or problems or difficulties before being lost without Jesus, the difference now is when I go through difficulties, I have somebody going through them with me. The Holy Spirit of God, my relationship in Christ, where before I was just on my own trying to ferret that out. What is going on and how come?
It was the Scottish theologian Sinclair Ferguson. I think he was right when he said this, talking about the way to life being difficult, and there are few who find it. He said this, he said, we cannot reach our destination if we are traveling in the wrong direction. And there's so much truth to that. And we see that, right, playing out in these two verses in front of us. If we desire to be saved and truly live the Christian life, and you say, well, wait a minute, I don't desire to be saved, I am saved. Okay, then for you, if you truly desire to live the Christian life, the unvarnished truth of it all is that we need to know that there will be some hardships and difficulties along the way. And if you haven't experienced any of those, I'll connect you with some people who have. And they can encourage you, because it's not a matter of if you will face difficulties. It's when. It's when. So, how do we unpack this? How do we take a look at this? Well, maybe you can outline this in a different way than what I'm about to, but this is how it speaks to my heart, and I share this with you this morning. We note first about this difficult way, first of all, we should not be surprised. We should not be surprised. We've been warned. If you read the Bible, if you study the Bible, if you're in the Word of God in any way, shape, or form as a believer, you've been warned about how difficult the life leading to eternal life can be. This walk with God. Jesus warned us in our text and elsewhere. In John chapter 15, verses 18 through 20, Jesus said this, if the world hates you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. If you are of the world would love its own. Yet because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. Remember the word that I said to you, a servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they kept my word, they will keep yours. Talk to those believers in China and India and places around Israel and Pakistan and Nigeria and other countries. And see what they say in response to what Jesus says right here. As a believer, reading articles recently about things going on in Indonesia to believers and around the world. Jesus made it known here. Remember the word that I said to you, the servant's not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will also persecute you. And I think in our country, we know very little of that in comparison to countries around the world. You got up this morning, you had your Wheaties, you know, you got yourself ready, you got in your nice car, you drove out a nice sunny, and you commented, oh, what a beautiful day today. What a great day to go worship the Lord with the believers at South Swansea. And here we are. Nobody's pounding on our door. Nobody's threatening to take us away. Nobody's showing up here saying, we know where you live, and because you are here, we're firebombing your house. And you look and you say to the authorities, help us. And the authorities say, we can't. They that want to do that are greater than the force that we can employ. That's what happens around the world. And before we find ourselves saying, whoa, woe is me, how come? Jesus says, you've been warned. Don't be surprised. As the clock ticks on, you will see more and more around this going on around the world. And we've basically been insulated and isolated through an ocean on one side of us and an ocean on the other side of us, and we had friends to the south of us and we had friends to the north of us, but now that's not so much the case. Would you call that a difficult way? In John 16:33, Jesus said, "These things I've spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world," he said, "you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer." And I love this. Jesus says, "I have overcome the world." The song that we just, it's kind of a new song. Didn't hear many people singing it because I don't know how many people knew it. But I know I was singing along with the words, but I love the song, "He Will Hold Me Fast." What's going on in your life? He will hold me fast. What are the challenges that you face? He will hold you fast. We have to remind ourselves of that on a daily basis. He will hold us fast. We've been warned by Jesus. We've been warned by Paul. We see Paul's warning to his fellow disciples in Acts 14:22 when he talks about strengthening the souls of the disciples, exhorting them to continue in the faith, saying to them, "We must through many tribulations enter the kingdom of God." It's going to happen. And for some people, it already is. And I'm not talking, you know what, you got out this morning and you're going to your car so you can come to church and you walk around and see you got a flat tire. Oh, God, why is this tribulation befalling me? I don't think that's what Paul's alluding to or what Jesus makes reference to. In 2 Timothy 3:12, Paul writes to this young protege in the faith, he says, "Yes, and all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution." Did you see that? Did you hear that? He says, "Yes. Let his yea be yea and the nay be nay." Paul's writing Timothy, "Yes. And all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution." So what's the alternative to that? For you as a believer to say, "Well, I just won't live godly then." Well, that's not an option. That's not what we do. That's not what we're about. Peter, in his letter, was writing to believers who were scattered abroad in 1 Peter chapter. In fact, I'll tell you what, turn 1 Peter chapter 4 with me if you would. 1 Peter chapter 4. I want you to see this along with me. First Peter chapter 4, in his letter to those who are scattered abroad, in verse 12, Peter says, "Beloved, do not think it strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened to you." If we could all get on a little chartered plane right now, right? If we could all get on a chartered plane right now and take a trip to Northeast India, right? Place where up to 300 Christian churches have been burned. People pulled out, drug into the street and persecuted, beat in the public places because they identify with Jesus as a Christian. And if we could all leave here and get on that plane and fly in there stealthily and get to a point where we could all see what's going on and maybe even have the privilege of talking to some of these folks and relate that to what Peter says here. "Beloved, don't think it's strange concerning the fire trial. It's to try you as though some strange thing happened to you." So you come up to one of these people and say, "Don't you think this is strange what's going on?" I think they would say to you, "Not at all. The Bible talks about this." "Well, what are you doing?" "We're standing fast for Christ." "Well, what are you doing?" "We're seeking to wear that armor of God." I was sitting with my wife the other day and I said, "You know, it's amazing to me. I'm reading this correspondence from off the Christian wire, and I always double check, you know, back check, look, make sure we're getting the information correct. And I'm sitting there and I said, here we are sitting in the comfort of the living room on 25 Church Street. The sun is out. We're having a delicious beverage in the comfort of our home talking about this. But get on a plane and go to that part of the world and it's a war zone for believers. How is that? He said, don't think it's strange. Peter's writing to these who were scattered abroad. Why? Because of their faith. Jesus and his apostles, they have given full disclosure to us that the way to life is difficult. Listen, the deal, we have enemies here. That's what in 1 Peter chapter 5, right? 1 Peter chapter 5, beginning in verse 8, if you're already in 4, look at 5:8. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. And Peter says, resist him steadfast in the faith, not resist him running from your faith, not resist him cowering from your faith, not resist him turning your back on your faith, but resist him steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same sufferings are experienced by your brotherhood, listen, in the world. Peter's writing to them, what you're going through right now is happening in the then known world. It's still going on today. People who think us, people who think us strange. Sometimes this persecution, these enemies are people who think us strange, ridicule or ostracize. 1 Peter chapter number 4, Peter writes to them verses 3 and 4. Don't think it's strange those who would ridicule, those who would ostracize, those who would seek to put you on the peripheral, on the edges, if you would. Again, don't think it strange concerning the fiery trial which is to come, which is to try you as though some strange thing happened to you, but rejoice to the extent that you partake of his sufferings, that when his glory is revealed, you may also be glad with exceeding joy. We have the enemies, not only the devil who walks about as a roaring lion, not only those who would seek to ridicule you for your faith, not only those who would seek to ostracize you or put you on the peripheral. And we see some of that going on even in this country, even where we live. First Peter chapter 2, Peter talks to them about the lust of the flesh with its bad habits and all. Beloved, I beg you as sojourners and pilgrims, abstain, he says, from fleshly lust, which war against the soul. John refers to the desire of the flesh in 1 John chapter 2. Another enemy, the desire of the flesh, desire of the eyes, and the pride of life. Without, those forces working without, those forces working within, making the way to life difficult. See, the Word of God tells us, and that's where Jesus begins here. When Jesus says in Matthew chapter 7, he talks about this narrow way. The narrow is the gate, and he says difficult is that way. Confining is that way. We looked at that last time we were together, but we can't just leave that be now. We have to focus in on that again. We have to think about that. Now, why do we think about it? Because when life gets difficult for you as a believer, as it has for others around the world, and as it's getting for some in this country, what's our attitude with that? Well, as I look at the scripture here, one of the attitudes
Listen, we should not be resentful about it. That we're taught in God's word. We are told to rejoice. We saw this in Jesus' sermon in Matthew chapter 5. Remember, digressing back in verses 10 through 12, he said, "Blessed are you who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when they revile and persecute you and say all kinds of evil against you for my name's sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven." I remember one of the first times I heard testimony from those in an underground church in China, and people said, "Listen, we got to pray for you. You're being persecuted. You're underground. Your church above ground is destroyed. They're going into your homes and doing all." And you know what their response was? "Well, we appreciate the prayer, but what we're actually praying for you is that you might understand, you might go through some of the persecution we're going through, so you better fall in love with your Jesus." I thought, wow, isn't that strange? But to help us better understand what they're going through, these Chinese believers were saying, "We're going to pray that you endure some of the same persecution we do. Then you will better understand love for Jesus and his love for you." So the attitude that we have with these forces that make the way difficult, we should not be resentful. We're told to rejoice. In James' letter, in James 1:2, he says, "My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials." Be happy. How many of us do that? Oh, yay, I hope I have a trial today. The example of the apostles when they were persecuted in Acts 5:41, the Bible says, "So when they departed from the presence of the council, they rejoiced that they were counted worthy to suffer shame for his name." Hey, have you ever stopped as you read through those passages? Have you ever scratched your head and said, "Wait a minute, they're persecuted, they're going through trial and tribulation, they get stoned, they get left for dead, they have bad things happen to them, and yet they're going on their way rejoicing"? You ever scratch your head and wonder about that? Because if ever you face persecution, or you're having a bad day, or there's too much month and not enough money, or there's not enough food in the cupboards, or you're wondering how ends are going to be met, or you're sharing your faith and somebody gets hypercritical at you, I know what you do. You say, "Praise the Lord, thank you, God. Give me more. Bring it on. Allow more." No, I don't think that's what we do. But why is it then that Jesus and his apostles say, when you run through these difficulties that lead unto eternal life, before you get to heaven and you enjoy the culmination of your salvation experience in Christ, why is it that we read in the scripture about the rejoicing and the joy and the happiness and all of that when they get together, when they've been through some terrible times? They say, "Rejoice." Why is that? One thing that comes to my mind that jumps off the page as I read this thing, they tell us to rejoice through these moments because it's when we do, it makes us stronger. It makes us stronger. You say, I'm not tracking with you. Listen, in Romans chapter 5, Paul gloried in his tribulations. And if there was anybody outside of Jesus who could have complained, who could have kicked that can down the road, who could have got upset every time somebody asked him for an interview about the tribulation and the trials he was going through, if there was anybody he had complaint, and he could have verbalized that, but he didn't. In Romans 5:3-4,
The Bible says, and not only that, Paul writes, but we also glory in tribulations, knowing that tribulation produces perseverance, and perseverance character, and character hope. Paul said to the Corinthian believers in 2 Corinthians 12, therefore I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in needs, in persecutions, in distresses, for Christ's sake, for when I am weak, then I am strong. We don't like the list of the infirmities and the reproaches and the needs and the persecution and the distresses, especially for Jesus' sake. But Paul said it's a result of going through those things. When I am weak, he said, then I am strong. And that's what I read. When in my mind, growing up in this nation with the privileges and things that we enjoy, that's what I read when I read about places in Pakistan and Nigeria and Indonesia and China and Russia and name the countries. When they undergo persecution, the believers there say, yes, we're going through these things, but then when we're weak by those things, we are made strong in Him. And it really makes me take another look at my walk with God and our Christianity that we tout. James said it this way in James 1, 2 through 4. Brethren, he said, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. But let patience have her perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. What does he say? Count it all joy when you fall in these trials. Hey, brother, how you doing? Man, I feel like $1 million. Why? Oh, I witnessed to somebody and they punched me out and left me on the street. Really? What did you do? I got up and I rejoiced in Jesus. You know what your first thought would be? Man, he's got a few screws loose. But you know what, isn't that? We see that happening throughout the Bible. When they were persecuted for faith in Christ, they all got together and they rejoiced that they were counted faithful. When these nations that we've mentioned time and time again, when they go through things, do they want to go through them? No. Do they enjoy going through it all? No. But they find joy somehow in that. And they count themselves faithfully strengthened and built up in that faith. Austrian poet Rainer Rilke wrote, in the difficult are the friendly forces, the hands that work on us. Again, pastor and theologian Sinclair Ferguson, he said this. He said, spiritual growth depends on two things. First, a willingness to live according to the word of God. And second, a willingness to take whatever consequences that emerge as a result. And I like that. We get that first part down. We want the willingness to live according to the word of God. But then the second is to take whatever consequences that emerge as a result of living for and in and by the word of God. See? And this is where we talk about this difficult way. We're to rejoice, not resent, when trials and tribulations befall us on the way to life. What may appear to be stumbling blocks leading to heartbreak may in fact be stepping stones leading to victory, especially as we consider why we should not be defeated, why we should not give up. Now, two thoughts on this, and we're going to jump into our conclusion. I'm going to cut short, all right? Two thoughts why we shouldn't be defeated. Number one, we have God on our side. If he be for us, who can be against us? Number one, we have God on our side. And he will not allow us to be tempted beyond our ability to endure, according to 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13a, no temptation has overtaken you but such is common to man, but God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able. Secondly, he'll provide a way of escape, enabling us to endure. But the temptation, he says, with the temptation, will also make that way of escape. And that way, you can look it up and study it for yourself. That way doesn't always indicate that way is going to be a smooth path. Or that way is going to be on waters as calm as glass. He makes that way, but sometimes that's a rocky way. Sometimes that's a bumpy way. Sometimes it's a disturbing way. But it is still a way that he has made for us. It was not there prior. He makes the way of escape that we may be able to bear it. And this includes strength to stand strong. His Holy Spirit empowers our inner man, according to Ephesians 3:16. Says that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might through his Spirit in the inner man. His armor protects us in the good fight. Our VBS this year was all about that. The armor of God. Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 18. It starts with putting on that armor of God and then praying always. And going ahead in him. So we should not be defeated. One, we have God on our side. And secondly, we have Jesus to inspire us. Now think about this. The book you're holding, it's not the New York Times. It's not the Encyclopedia Britannica. It's the Word of God. And in it, we see the life of our Lord Jesus lived. We see his death, we see his burial, we read of his resurrection, we read of his coming again. And we look forward to that coming again. But we have him to inspire us. He provides for us an example for us to follow, and even an example in time of suffering. 1 Peter 2:21, for to this you were called, the Bible says. Because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that you should follow, I should follow, we should follow in his steps. We look to him, according to Hebrews chapter 12, as we seek to endure. He's the one who's the author and the finisher of our faith. He's the beginning, he's the end, and he's everything in between. Like that deacon of old, Stephen, you remember? Stephen stood and he preached and shared the word of God, and people gnashed their teeth at him and they were upset with him. So what did they decide to do? Have a pleasant invitation to receive Christ? No, they took up rocks to stone him. And is this stoning him to put them to death? What does he do? Much like the example of Jesus on the cross, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. They know not what they do. Father, forgive them. By the very example of Jesus and others, we have an inspiration and motivation to live the life that he's called us to. Now, before you leave here this morning and say, yeah, okay, that's all well and good, but, you know, hey, what about me? What about this? What about that in my life? It's not to say that we'll never misstep along life's way. As Christians, if we're not careful, as Christians, there's still that thing called sin. 1 John 1:8 says, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. The truth is not in us. 1 John 1:10 says, if we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. But when we stumble, we also know that in him we have mercy and we have forgiveness, according to 1 John 1:7. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin. And if we confess our sin, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So what are we saying? As we walk this road to eternal life, your sky's not always going to be bluer. Your grass is not always going to be greener. Your water is not always going to be smooth. It's going to be bubbling and broiling at times. So as you travel this way of life, we may find it difficult at times, but don't be surprised, the Bible says to us.
Don't be resentful, the Bible teaches us. Don't be defeated, the Bible teaches us. But as the writer to Hebrews penned in his letter in Hebrews chapter 12, he said, therefore, strengthen the hands which hang down, the feeble knees. Make straight paths for your feet so that what is lame may not be dislocated, but rather be healed. He says to us, pursue peace with all people and holiness, without which no one will see the Lord. Look carefully, lest anyone fall short of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness spring up and cause you trouble, and by this many become defiled. So what is he saying to us? According to Hebrews 12, it's much like the song we sang when we ended. Realize every day in your life, when head gets off the pillow, you live your day. When head goes back to pillow at the end of that day, greet him in the morning, meet him in the evening, and know that whatever life throws at you, he will hold you fast. Oswald Chambers, let's end by a quote, with a quote from him. My utmost for his highest, the author. Oswald Chambers states, and I find it helpful, he said this, Jesus Christ reveals, not an embarrassed God, not a confused God, not a God who stands apart from the problems, but one who stands in the thick of the whole thing with man. And that's where we find ourselves today. That's where these people in far nations we talked about find themselves today, in the midst of it all. They don't see an embarrassed God. In the midst of it all, they don't see a confused God. In the midst of it all, they don't see a God who stands on the peripheral apart from their problems, like he has no solution, like they're left to themselves. What they see is a God who stands in the thick of the whole thing with them. And they rejoice in his name, that they've been counted worthy to go through what their Savior went through, knowing that one day they'll be with him. May we never forget. Amen? Father, thank you for your word, and thank you for this opportunity you give to us. Help us, as Keith prayed this morning, to be willing to talk with those, to speak with those who are on this very broad way, this expansive area that leads to destruction. And there are many who go in by it. Help us to be there to share with them the wonderful words of life. Help us to encourage one another in the faith as we go through together some of the difficult experiences that are just life. And they happen, they occur. Jesus talks about this narrowing of this way and how difficult it is, which leads to life. May we be encouraged in you, God, to keep our eyes fixed like a flint upon you, to keep our heart purposed upon you, to keep our life and our walk fastened upon you. Thank you for your word. Thank you for this time. Thank you for who you are today, Lord, working in and through our lives. And again, we're grateful that you hold us fast. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you and have a great day in the Lord. Amen.